Well, actually, I would like to start by asking you a question. So what do you think when I say laser? What's the first thing that pops into your mind? Maybe anyone can venture an answer for my question. So especially, I'm kind of triggering it here. So I guess if, depending a little bit on the age group, I see a lot of young people, I might get an answer from some kind of science fiction saga, a little bit more towards new American sitcoms where geeky physicists spend their time in the lab building lasers. Those two answers are probably truly the most popular way of diffusing the ideas of lasers. But I guess what I would try to convince you about today is that lasers are a lot more than that. Actually, you would be surprised at how many things in your daily life are affected by lasers. I might actually even change my first question, so not what do you think when I say laser, but what would you do a day without lasers? Do you have an idea of what would happen to your lives? So in the program, I wrote, like, would you take a bet if I tell you I give you $1,000 to go one day without lasers? Well, actually, my answer would be no, because I know, but most obviously most people would think, yeah, well, actually, I don't really need lasers. I don't build lasers in my garage, so I don't really need them in my everyday life, right? So actually, lasers are truly everywhere. It is in applications that one knows, like, for example, laser surgery for eye surgery and things like that, and those are pretty commonly known. But there's a lot of hidden applications that one doesn't know. For example, in medicine, of course, one, I mentioned one that's pretty obvious, but there's other more advanced, for example, imaging techniques that rely on lasers. There's a lot of manufacturing parts in your, for example, in your cars or in your daily objects that you use that are manufactured using lasers, maybe not directly. For example, if you own a modern car, most likely the injection nozzle that is in your car that's distributing the fuel is made with lasers. I recently found out from a company that actually sells lasers that they provide to companies who manufacture jeans, you know, that look a little bit worn out. That's actually made with lasers nowadays. So it's really amazing. So the spread out applications of these lasers, and these are only some examples that I somehow managed to get. Just if you type laser applications, you find already a lot of things. What is it that makes lasers so special, actually? What is the difference between the light that you get from a light bulb and a laser? So it's kind of obvious, right? When you see it, you can tell me already what the difference is. I mean, this is not a very powerful laser, but the main aspects that really stick to you from a laser, maybe from Star Wars or from the obvious places where you know lasers from, is basically their intensity, their dimensionality, and their spectral purity. What are these things? The intensity is just simply the brightness, that you, the impression that it's a very bright ray of light. The dimensionality is basically the idea that the laser will propagate for very long distances, relatively unchanged in most cases, and the spectral purity is basically that it's made of one color or very few colors. And these properties are actually related to something that in laser physics we call coherence. So coherence in terms of light is not something easy to understand. We'll probably need a few hours physics lecture to explain, so I will not go into that, but I'll try to explain to you how, if you just relate to the coherence that you find in the dictionary, you can kind of understand what I'm talking about. So if I actually tell you that you guys are a laser, right? So every one of you is a particle that forms the laser beam, right? So that's what we call photons, the particles that make the laser light. If I ask you all to act coherently, you probably don't get what I'm trying to tell you. Now, if I give you a few more details, you might understand. So if I ask you all to together raise your hands up and down at the same time, most likely what will happen at the beginning is everybody will do a little bit here and there and at a different rhythm, and that will be incoherent, right? So that's what we call incoherent light. It would be the light that comes out from a regular lamp, right? Now if I say, okay, now I'll set a pace, everybody goes at the same pace and a time, everybody lifts their hands up and down at the same time, then what will happen? Everybody will be coherent. And coherent can mean several things in terms of lasers or in terms of what the experiment we're doing now. So I can say, okay, we are all spatially coherent, so everybody in the audience at the same location is doing the same thing. Or we can be temporally coherent, so you are doing something over there, lifting your hands up and down, and you are doing it at another rhythm that's related. So of course there are many dimensions and many definitions of what coherence is, but lasers all have some of it in some aspect. So what do you actually need? If I tell you now, okay, you're experts, you know what you need and what a laser light is made of, what do you need to build it in your garage, right? First of all, laser means light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. So that's a technical term, right? It doesn't really mean anything for anyone, but definitely doesn't say Star Wars when you read it, right? So the first building brick that you need is what we call the laser medium, so a gain medium, right? Where to create these well-behaved photons of light that we say are coherent, right? So well, this first brick of the laser dates all the way back to Albert Einstein. In 1916, so more than 100 years ago, he came up with the idea, well, to generate these very well-behaved photons, I have an idea that might generate them and might actually amplify them. And this is the so-called stimulated emission, right? If you have an atom that you manage to excite and you put the right kind of light in your crystal or, for example, in your gain medium, then the photons that are already present will be amplified and will have the same behavior as the previous photons. So now the only thing you need is an input source of energy. You excite the atoms, you create this excited state, then you bring some photons in, for example, via light or via electricity, and then these will get amplified. And now the only thing you need to do is to create lots of them because you want a powerful beam. And this can be made, for example, with a feedback loop. And in this case, what we do is we just put mirrors around our gain, and then the light will bounce back and forth, and then that's it. This is what's inside of here. So you have a laser gain medium, then some kind of input energy source, a resonator, and you have your laser. Now, the first laser was made nearly 50 years after the first proposition that Albert Einstein made for stimulated emission. This was actually took a lot of work to realize that this is how to do it. But since then, actually, things have progressed enormously. The laser technology has evolved so much to lead to all these amazing applications. And on top of that, there have been in research many, many Nobel Prizes dedicated to laser and laser technology. And apart from that, of course, laser technology has progressed enormously. So just to give you an example, here is the most powerful laser in the world. So the kinds of things that people do with lasers nowadays are really incredible. So the National Ignition Facility in California, they are actually trying to create fusion to have sources of clean energy, right? And so in the goal of saying how do lasers help to make a better world, people are trying to do these things, right? And routinely in these experiments, NIFs, laser beams, create temperatures and pressures similar to those that exist inside of the stars. So this is actually truly amazing what progress led to these kind of experiments. Now, I told you I'm going to talk about ultra-fast lasers. It's another kind of laser. So the laser that, for example, this laser pointer that I have here emits continuously. So it will emit light, this nice, well-behaved, coherent light, but all the time. Now, ultra-fast lasers are a little bit different. They will emit light in short bursts, right? And these short bursts will have very special characteristics. So the one important thing is their duration. They're very, very, very short. And the other important thing is they will be very, very, very tall because the energy is then spread out in a much shorter time. And just to give you a scale of what these values mean, a femtosecond laser can generate peak powers of gigawatts. Some systems even generate terawatts. Okay, so which means that for a very short time, you have available the power of one to hundreds of nuclear power plants in your laser that you have standing in your lab. Of course, it's for a very short time duration. The power plant operates kind of continuously, right? Then, to give you an idea how short this time scale is, one femtosecond, just you can compare it to a distance that might feel more familiar for you. If you measure the distance from the Earth to the Sun with the thickness of a hair, it would be comparable as measuring 1 second passing by with a femtosecond precision. So that means you can imagine then the things you can measure and the things you can see at that time of time scales, right? So actually these ultra-fast lasers and really allow you to access these timescales that are really unique. Things that happen in femtoseconds are processes, for example, of motions of electrons around atoms, so really fundamental processes. And this gives you a tool to take pictures of these events, right? Inspired by, for example, flash photography, which is basically the simplest kind of advanced photography. You can just take many, many flashes and follow a certain movement. Here, for example, how an apple falls. You can do the same now. You have much shorter flashes. You can see in very, very detail, much, much smaller scales happening live, right? For example, chemical reactions, folding and unfolding of proteins, because we saw this morning from Simon. So this morning, a few hours ago. So in actually, other applications, of course, are possible due to these very short timescales, right? Telecommunications, interconnects inside of computers. And all these are kind of coming together because laser technology is evolving so fast. Now, the laser pulses can also be seen not only from the time domain. So I told you, okay, it's bursts of light. So instead of having a continuous light, you have pulsed coherence in time. So once in a while, all these colors will come together and then form a coherent pulse. And this is how you basically end up with a burst of light. So since an ultrafast laser can also be seen as a superposition of all these millions of frequencies, it can also basically be seen as a ruler in the frequency domain. Every color is one frequency, and you have millions of them available, and they are all nicely equidistant and well-behaved. So you can use it as a frequency to measure very, very fast oscillations. And this is actually the concept called the frequency comb, right? Because it looks a bit like a comb. Only each comb line is terahertz frequencies. It's extremely fast. So you can use it, for example, to measure unknown frequencies of extremely fast oscillations. Now, the other aspect, and the last aspect that I'm going to talk about, is these ultrafast lasers. We talked about the property of spatial coherence. You can focus them very, very tight into very small spots. Now, if you add on top of that, that you have for very short times a very high peak power, you can access extremely high peak intensities. And there, you can interact very well with materials. And by interact, I mean burn in some cases. But by interact, I mean also modify and create the type of surfaces that you might be looking for. Right? So basically, advances in laser have made it possible manufacturing and processing of so many different kinds of materials, from plastics to metals to all the parts that you use in your daily objects, right? And so, so fast due to the increase of the, for example, power of these ultra-fast lasers. Now, what do we do? And by we, I mean research groups like mine or research groups in the laser community. We try to constantly push the frontiers of these lasers, right? So, for example, in terms of power, in terms of pulse duration, we want shorter pulses, we want higher power, we want higher energy. We want the best lasers possible to be able to use them to better understand what's going on around us. Of course, this is kind of our dream and our specific group, but this is something that a lot of other researchers are doing, right? We are not the only ones. And in our specific case, what we want is to increase the average power. So why do we want to increase the average? How does that provide a better tool for all these measurements that I showed you before? And increasing the average power simply means that you have more pulses per second. For a given pulse, lower average power, less pulses per second. Higher average power, more and more pulses per second, which means I have more events per second. And for all of the pictures that I showed you before, so the picture of following a movie of a molecule or something moving around, or simply for processing of materials, that just means increasing the speed and increasing the data rate. So that means it provides a better tool for understanding things at a much, much faster scale. And what we are specifically using in our group these lasers for is to understand water. So Simon gave already a talk about folding and unfolding of proteins. He set up the stage very nicely for the kind of experiments that we do using our lasers. We provide you lasers that have much higher repetition rates, so much more pulses per second, in order to investigate then what does the water do around, for example, the protein. Does it play a role? We want to know what the water does. Is it only a passive? Is it just sitting there? We want to follow the dynamics, see if it plays a role. And that is basically the research that we are doing right now. So just anecdotally, we are also kind of geeks. So in the lab, we're like some once in a while, we have a record result, and so we also celebrate things. So the images you have of the Big Bang Theory are not necessarily wrong. So this was in 2012 when I demonstrated the highest power for one of these type of lasers. So I was very happy because it was the work of many, many years. And so we were celebrating with balloons and with champagne in the lab. So then, this I would like to finish, and I hope that I convinced you that lasers are a lot more than those two things, although, of course, we have to be grateful for Hollywood for spreading the word of lasers. Thank you very much.